So, welcome back. We're now in chapter 10, geometry, 2D nodes, two-dimensional nodes. Okay, so let's take a look at these guys. This is one of the easiest chapters, probably the easiest chapter in the whole book, and the easiest set of nodes. Why? Because they're only 2D, they're flat instead of 3D. But here's what we go through, and first is keeping it in context. The 2D nodes are one of four different chapters we have on geometry. And we started out with the primitives, box and sphere and cylinder and text and so forth. Then we did points, lines, and polygons, which we saw a lot of different things. Point set, line set, of course. And then index face set was our workhorse node where we could draw just about anything. And then we had a few specialties like extrusion and elevation grid. But now the geometry 2D nodes, these are quite simple. And you might ask, well, why did we even bother? Why did we bother with flat 2D nodes? And answer, for convenience. So we'll look at that and see why that is. And then finally, we end up with triangles and quadrilaterals down in chapter 13. And you know, so you might think of convenience. They're more of a high performance node because they're closer to how things actually get rendered in the graphics processing unit. The sometimes it's helpful for tools to convert your geometry into these low-level triangle sets instead of just working with index face sets. But that's the suite of four different chapters. We're in geometry 2D, which is the simplest. The good news in all of these is that the same design pattern holds true. We use a shape node, the outer container, put your geometry node in there. Right next to it, you can have an appearance, which in turn would contain a material and or a texture and or the other things that can modify textures. Okay, so very consistent throughout. In 2D, the common concepts are simple for simple nodes, and then we have a helpful long list of, what is it, 8 nodes here that we can draw. Okay, so let's look at what these are about. Why do we want these convenience nodes? Well, it often happens when you're building, even when you're working in 3D, if you're building a sign or a little user interface or something like that, that you don't need full up 3D nodes. Now, that's not commonplace. I mean, most of the time we're working in 3D, so we want 3D nodes. But nevertheless, it's common enough with these 2Ds that sometimes, well, we don't want to worry about that third dimension. We're just trying to put a box up as a backdrop to something. So that occurred often enough that when we looked back at Vermal 97, when we got to X3D as the third generation, when we reviewed people's wish lists of what features do they wish were in there added to X3D, this is pretty far up there. Since they were easy to create, and since it might encourage conversion of things like SVG or other 2D languages, SVG being scalable vector graphics, where it's all about drawing 2D shapes, we said, well, why not? Let's put in a suite of simple two-dimensional shapes that would make it easy for authors to just drop those things in there. Okay? Do you have to have them? No. You could use index face set. You could use some of the other 3D nodes that are already existing. You could use line set, index line set for the line nodes. However, and the proof of that was we never had them in Vermal 97. We didn't have the 2D nodes. However, they did prove useful. And in fact, at one point NPS here, we wrote prototypes to show the functionality of the 2D nodes, but written as 3D. And basically, they had the same signature, the same fields, and the prototype would build an index face set using a script as a way of emulating native support for those nodes. So that was a great design step as we went along to 2D to make sure all the nodes were designed well. They were implementable by anybody. In fact, companies, if they didn't want to write code for the 2D nodes, they could just use our prototypes and plug it in that way and get built-in native support. Okay, so the notion of convenience or utility methods, convenience, utility capabilities, is pretty common in a lot of languages. You have to be careful. We don't want to bloat it. We don't want to make the vocabulary so gigantic that nobody can use it. Who decides? Well, the community. So inputs from the community. Many users told the X3D working group, yes, we want these nodes. A lot were developed. We're seeing the fruits of that labor here. The group agreed that yes, these are valuable. Okay. Now, if you're building a very high-powered, fancy 2D user interface, you might find these helpful. You might find that they're not quite rich enough for what you want to do. My guess is that if you're doing a serious user interface design, you're probably programming, writing code in a interface to a program, and that might be a better way to do it. Or you're just getting really serious about the 3D nodes in X3D and making them work. Both are possible. Still, it's good to think of the 2D nodes as maybe a quickie way to put little user interface type widgets in there. And if you're clever and careful about it, you could build a quite sophisticated interface nevertheless. Okay, more common concepts is a warning. Look out, you might miss it. Since by their very nature, they're flat, two-sided polygons, it's quite easy when you get a polygon on the side to not be able to see it whatsoever. Okay, so, you know, well, why would I look at it on the side? And, well, it depends where you are, where your viewpoint is, and it depends where the polygon is, if it's flat on or not. So you have to be careful about that. Further, if you're looking at the backside, you might miss it if it's not a two-sided geometry. So yes, this is a precaution. Is it any different than other 3D geometry? No, same precaution. You want to be able to see it. If we made a box that was exceedingly flat in one dimension, it would be hard to see from the side. If we make an index face set that's simply a rectangle or some other polygon, and we look at it edge on, well, it has no width, so the graphics card won't draw it. Same thing. So the precaution here is you're particularly prone to this with 2D because there's no backup. So be careful and make sure you do it right. Okay. Some ways to make sure you get it right are, well, if you put it in a billboard, that will always face the user. Another way is we'll see different ways of building heads-up displays that stay on the screen in a fixed place no matter where the user navigates to in the world. The screen stays the same. Okay. And then, since points and lines are not aspect dependent, angle dependent, where you look at them, we don't really have to worry about missing them quite as much. Okay. Talked a little bit about this. They are new to X3D, so you might not find as many past content that does it, but that's okay. They're straightforward and usable. So there is a prerequisite. Since it's not in the normal immersive profile, you might have to list geometry 2D as a component statement in the scene header. And we'll see how to do that in a couple of slides. So that's a prerequisite. Now, we did mention a minute ago that we produced some of those replacement normal prototypes. So if you are working in a X3D scene and want to go back to Vermal, and that would be the same as saying a .x3D file name to a .wrl file, perhaps for backwards compatibility with some other tool, and you have some of those 2D nodes and go, hey, wait a minute, I can't use them in Vermal? Well, the answer, you can. If you use our style sheet, it will notice those. It will know that you're going to Vermal right there. So it will automatically insert the declarations for those nodes using our prototypes. Now, the details about prototypes are in chapter 14, so we won't go through there just yet. we'll cover the hows and what, wherefores of that, but we will point it out here in case you have that issue. Okay. Okay, so here we are back, and the next slide shows, what's that component statement about again? You may recall this from early in the course when we had the technical overview. X3D is extensible. The way we do that is with components. And so the 2D nodes as a whole typically need to be turned on. Okay, so if you're using the immersive profile for your browser, then you have to tell it that, hey, I want the 2D nodes as well. And so you add this statement in your header that should precede the meta tags, which might come after that. And then everybody's happy. Okay. There's a similar syntax if you're working in the classic Vrml, which is similar to Vrml 97, but I guess I should scratch Vrml 97 from there since they weren't supported in that. And the similar syntax in the headers looks right like that. If you're working with the immersive profile, then we say geometry 2D component. And level 2 means all of them, all of the existing nodes. Level 1 is a subset. And we won't worry too much about that. Okay, so there is the syntax for your X3D scene. So if your browser's yelling at you mad, hey, I don't know about 2D, please check that to make sure you got it. Okay, here we are. So what common fields do we have? Well, not so many. Most of the common fields we've seen before in the prior geometry chapter with index face set, points, lines, polygons, we saw a bunch of them. Counterclockwise, convex, colored per vertex, crease angle, some other things. We don't have those. Why? Because 2D is too simple. The triangles don't need any of those special effects. However, they do have two sides. So we use our old favorite, solid equals false. Remember the mnemonic, the memory trick for solid is, if it's solid like a brick, you can't see inside a brick. So solid false means two-sided. Solid true equals one-sided. The technical term for that remains backface culling. It gets culled out. The backfaces, the reverse sides of your polygons, aren't shown. If you're wondering which side is the front side, well, normally we use the right-hand rule for that, but we don't define the values for these 2D nodes by front or back. So the answer to front and back is, if you create that node, they're typically about the origin, the side facing out along the positive z-axis where the default camera is, that's going to be the front side. Okay, so we have, maybe I should draw a picture here, but maybe it's too simple. If we have some 2D node and we have the X and Y like that, then Z is going to be out, coming out of the front, right? Try it yourself with the right hand rule in front of that little diagram and go, okay, yeah, Z is coming out of the screen. So that Z axis is going to be your positive normal vector. In other words, the side that's shown if you're single-sided. So that's how you would keep track of it. If you're worried about performance, please don't. These are only a couple of triangles in any case, and so the performance is going to be negligible. You will not be able to measure it or detect it, I predict. If you really care, because you're building tens of thousands of these things, okay, pay attention to them, but that's how you do it. Okay, then final common point about these things, a couple points, I guess, is one is all the stuff we've learned about material, appearance, texturing, line properties, fill properties, it's all the same. No change, so that's cool. And then access type initialize only. Okay, now that we've gone through the script channel, script chapter, that's probably sensible now. Initialize only means they're only paid attention to when they're first constructed. Oh, that means I can't send an event to them to change the dimensions of a 2D node. Oh, so if I want to change the side of it, how would we do that? Well, the answer is, if the question is, doctor, my arm hurts when I do this, well, don't do that. Don't change the internal parameters, instead just rescale them. Put a transform node above that shape, above that 2D node. Scale it, rotate it, translate it, whatever you want to do there. The rationale for why those are not exposed, why they're initialize only instead of modifying them, is because they tried to keep the code as lightweight as possible. They don't tell how, the spec does not tell browsers how to tessellate some of these shapes. How would you draw a circular arc? That would be a runtime expense to change those. So instead, it seems more efficient both for browser implementation and for runtime performance to say, what you got is what you got, and scale it externally instead of forcing the browser to recompute, retessellate all those triangles within a 2D shape. So that's the rationale. If you don't like it, okay. But that's what you got. All right, let's go through some of the nodes now. First one, ARC2D. Well, it is what it is. It is what it sounds like here. We get a beginning angle that we call start angle. We get end angle. It's got a radius. Notice the start and the end angles are relative to that x-axis. So you can't measure an angle unless you're measuring it from somewhere. Similarly, there you go. So the blue one arc here would be a positive sweep. The red would be a negative angle, negative sweep. And the allowed range of values is from negative 2 pi to positive 2 pi. Oh, so that's actually two sweeps around. There, 2 pi is 360 degrees in the positive direction. Negative 2 pi is full sweep. So it's actually more than two circles that you can do. That's so there's no discontinuity. So that means you can pick any pair of angles and get the arc you want. And it gives you flexibility in how to define that. Okay, of course it is radians, not degrees. So that's nothing new. And we use the right-hand rule. So once again, from the positive x to the positive y, right-hand rule up. Oh, yeah, that's the right direction, counterclockwise. All consistent. Okay, here's what the interface looks like. Is that Alfred Hitchcock profile? I don't know, but it is two ARC2Ds. And you can see the first one there, and the second one there, and two simple examples. Our interface is similarly unremarkable. Right now we have a times pi and divided by pi feature in there to try to facilitate entering degrees. Still a little clumsy. I think we might improve that in time degree, but if we do, we'll probably do it throughout the whole tool. The key is you've got to record radians. That's what goes into the file. So that's a factor of 2 pi. All right, so if it's 6.28, 2 pi radians, that's how we interpret those numbers. But nevertheless, it might be a good convenience method to get degrees and radians. If we do that, we'll do it consistently through the whole tool. Okay, let's do a quick look at the browsers and see what support they have. Okay, so here we are in X3D Edit. Have we seen our Dilbert for today? So you guys doing, are you guys doing the Dilbert thing? You like that feature? Is that just way too unprofessional for you?
Okay.
Highly paid, whatever it is you do. It's okay, it's not too offensive.
I get my Dilbert clicks.
You do. I know some of this is, you know, talking about selling brains to cannibals and spirits to demons, that might be spiritually questionable. I guess since it's Dilbert, we can live. All right, anyway. Thank you, Mr. Dilbert. So here's our example, and at least for today, what you won't see is XJ3D, because XJ3D is not yet supporting the 2D nodes. However, I think we do have pretty good support by all the other nodes, all the other players. So let's launch all the other players and see what we got. Okay, well, we're seeing a lot of examples come up here. Here I'm rotating in instant reality. Looks good. In Octoga, looks good. Swirl, looks good. I'm not sure what's wrong with BS Contact. And there we go. So yeah, so you think it's Alfred Hitchcock too, right? Yeah, that's what I thought. But Leonard made these. They're fine examples. And notice that we did have up at the top here that component level 2 geometry 2D. If we wanted to get rid of that, the way to get rid of that is you would have to change immersive to full. Full says, kitchen sink, give me all the components. However, I'd be very cautious about using full because most browsers are too modest to support that. If they don't have all the nodes and all the components, then full might not make sense. I prefer a more relaxed interpretation. I think full should be whatever it can handle, and then it should fail if it tells you that some browsers just won't even recognize it until they finish the job and get them all. So the recommended way to get 2D support in there is stick with immersive profile and the component statement. And as we can see, there are a number of examples that work. Okay, back to the slides. Oh, and there's our XJ3D, no joy on that. Okay, we do have our tooltips for Arc2D. And then let's look at the next one. So ArcClose2D. What's the difference? Well, this one's closed. The other one was just simply lines. This one is closed in the mathematical sense of the term. And so this is polygonal. It's fully shaded in. And if we were to look closely at these guys, we'd probably find that the polygons were not scribbles, but triangles. It will tessellate, so it might look something like that. And how close to the curve do you want to get? Well, how many triangles do you want to draw? You can get as close as you like to give the appearance of a smooth curve. Okay, what else? Two types of closed geometry, either chord, sounds musical, but it's the mathematical sense of the term. Chord is a line segment from two points on the circumference of a sphere. Or pi, as in apple or mom, a slice of pie, like that. If there are any mathematicians who want to protest the use of pi and say there's a better term, well, please let me know. I'm interested. Will we change this back? I doubt it, but because what we see is what we got, but it's fun to think about. Okay, what other restrictions? Radius must be greater than zero or it's considered an error. Why are we bothering? And then if our start angle and end angle, which had the same limits as before, if the difference between those is greater than 2 pi, meaning greater than a full revolution, then you get a full circle. You don't get 1 1/4 pi's or a double circle, it's just a complete circle. Okay, so our screen snapshot looks like this. We had the same definitions before, but instead of arc 2D, we have arc closed 2D. But you can see that the shapes are nearly identical to what we would have gotten with the others. We just made the chord version here and the pie version. Okay, pretty straightforward. I'm not even gonna bother with the interface. Let's just keep ripping through these guys. Our tooltips, we've got the boundaries in there for how big the sizes are, and so on and so forth. Okay, what do you think, Jeff? We can keep going? All right, 5 more minutes today. Let's do another note or two. Circle 2D. Well, line-based, meaning it's not filled in, and planar circle, meaning yes, it's 2D, and it gets a center and a positive radius, okay? There is a figure for this in the book, but it had a flaw in it, so here's the corrected figure for that. And now I'm superimposing where our X or Y axes, if we were looking at that. So again, this view is drawn as if we were from the default viewpoint, which is, of course, 0, 0, 10 meters out on the Z axis, looking back towards the origin. Okay, well, that looks simple and is simple. And here we are with a pair of circle 2Ds. And the first one's pretty straightforward. We've got a radius of 1, and there it is, right there. And then what do we have in the other one? Well, on this guy we've got a radius of 2, but it's worked. It's an oval. Why is that? Oh, because we scaled it non-uniformly. Notice that our factors here are a factor of 1 in x and a factor of 0.5 in y. So this is how we converted our circle into an oval. Non-uniform scaling in the parent transform. And this is why we don't need an oval 2D. We just use a circle 2D. Squish it, stretch it, rotate it. You can have any oval, any ellipse that you might want. Okay, what's the interface on this node? Simply a radius. Simple is good. Okay, next one. Disk 2D, very similar to circle 2D, but remember circle 2D was just lines and disk 2D is polygons. And rather than just make it a circle, filled in circle 2D, we called it a disk because a nice feature somebody suggested would be, well, why don't you give me an inner radius instead of an outer radius? So I could build things like a washer or some kind of brim on something that had a hole in the middle. That can be very useful. So therefore, there's two parameters for radius instead of a single one, inner and outer. Inner radius, outer radius. And the angles of those don't matter. It's always going to be a disk. It's always going to be circular. Now, did we even need this node? Well, if it's a fully filled in circle, in other words, a disk 2D with inner radius 0, we could have simply used an end cap of a cylinder node. Right? Turn off the sides, turn off one of the end caps, use the other end cap. But that wouldn't give us the hole in the middle. And also, it would be offset by whatever the height of the cylinder was. So that's why, hey, it's convenience node, let's make it convenient. We kept this guy. Once again, there are axes. Not much value except to tell us what the front side is, because the normal vector will be coming out of the screen here along the z-axis. Okay, and there are two examples, one of them totally filled in and the other one with an inner radius driving the hole in the middle, and you can see that they do have the same values as the circle 2D in the previous example. At least they have the same outer radius. Okay, and there are tool tips, and nothing new there except, yeah, we've got, as before, for the polygonal 2D nodes, we've got a solid field that lets us do one-sided or two-sided. Okay, so I think where we're at then is we will break for today. We've only got a few left, but we just got the first four done, and so the next session should be pretty cool. See you then.